Good morning and welcome back, some of you, to church. It's been a summer that a lot of people have been away, and it's good to have you back again. We started a series on forgiveness, the F words. Last summer it was forgiven, this way, forgiven by God. This summer it's this way, forgiving each other. Next Sunday is forgetting. And that's to do with up here. And then the following Sunday is forsaking. And that will be more of the heart decisions that we make. I'm going to use a lot of humor in my messages, so I'm going to just give you a few before I start. This woman was praying for her man. She says, "I pray, God, for wisdom to understand my man, love to forgive him, patience for his moods, because now, if I pray for strength, I'd beat him to death." So, I hope that's not the case in your home. Well, that was on the bicycle. And so, he asked God for one, and God didn't see the answer. So, he stood back and asked for forgiveness. And that's the way we do sometimes. When someone has a mission work in the north, our last born had a friend over for a sleepover. That was so bad, I went and got two Mr. Freezes of two different colors. She gave one to her friend Charlotte, and Charlotte said, "I don't like this color." And Dennis said to Charlotte, "The color tastes the same. That's the one we have." And we started an argument. I was sitting in the living room where they were sleeping in a pool of bed, and got them set up for the night, and Debbie slept on one extreme side, and Charlotte slept on the other extreme side. And that's why I could still feel the tension. It was thick for two 12 or 13 year old kids. So I took them to the bedroom, and I told them that I was going to leave them there until they had worked out. And so I forget that we looked at me with tears running down her face and says, "But Dad, you don't know how big this one is." I'll show you what I did. And they were going to stay there until they worked that through. It was very quiet for a long time. And then Sandy and I heard a little conversation, and we soon heard them talking and laughing. And today, they would laugh about the Mr. Freezy. Oh yeah, they remember it. It was one of those life experiences. We have all kinds of things to forgive over. This morning I have a YouTube that we're going to show that talks about forgiving someone who killed one of their children, I believe, as a drunk driver. And so can we play that?
Over the past few years, I've been on this journey of writing songs inspired by the real-life stories that people sent to me. This one story in particular has had a profound impact on me. It hit me kind of hard. It's about a woman who did the impossible and made me ask myself if I could do the same. Renee had four kids. Two of her daughters were twins.
Megan was coming home from the beach one night with her best friend when their car was struck by a drunk driver named Eric, a 24-year-old kid. Megan lost her life. Eric killed both girls that were in the car. Renee lost her daughter in an instant. Next thing she knows, she finds herself in a courtroom watching this young man, this 24-year-old man, get sentenced to 22 years in prison. Renee wrote to me and said, "I now have a mission that I never would have chosen." What she meant by that is that in the years that followed, she began to travel around to schools and churches and different functions, and she would speak about the dangers of drunk driving. But as the years progressed, she felt like something was missing from her presentation. And that's when God put it on her heart that she had not forgiven this man who took the life of her daughter. And so she reached out and did the impossible. She reached out to Eric in prison and said, "I forgive you." The ripple effects of that act of forgiveness are still being felt today. that young man's life was absolutely changed because this woman forgave him. He said, I can't even forgive myself, and she forgave me. Eric said he found his eternal salvation as a result of this act. One by one, all of Renee's family members followed her lead, and they reached out and expressed forgiveness to Eric. So much so that now they describe Eric as part of their family, like a son to Renee. The story doesn't stop there, though. Renee went to the courts along with her family, and she was able to have Eric's sentence cut in half from 22 years to 11 years. This blew me away. The reason she did it is so that Eric could have a second chance at life and so that he could join her in their presentations. She told me that now she shares not only about the dangers of drunk driving, but also about the power of forgiveness.
Now, the story behind this song is from someone right here in our area. We're going to let her tell the story. She won't know you're here. Are you comfortable with hiding?
I'm comfortable with hiding, yeah. I'm nervous right now.
You two are both just hiding.
She has no idea I'm here.
Yeah,
no.
She doesn't even,
this is the thing, she has no idea that there's been a song written inspired by her story. I'm in another room, waiting to go in there and surprise Renee. I can see her on a video screen. She has no idea I'm in the room right next to
And you submitted the story, I know, to Matthew West.
It's a story that needs to be told, right? Because not for me, it's not about me, it's about God, and yeah. It's about forgiveness. And so I thought, well, I'm just going to chance this. And I sent it in, and I just prayed, you know, God, if this is supposed to happen, then I just, you know, hope that it will.
You know, we know Matthew, and he wrote a song about your story.
No way.
Matthew has sent us the song because he wanted you to be one of the first people to hear it.
Hear it? Yes.
It's called Forgiveness.
It's called Forgiveness.
Have you ever seen him in concert, or
no?
Did you?
And I wanted to see him. I tried to go see him when he was in West Palm because I thought that I would have a presentation down there, and
right.
I thought,
during
and
the
then
story
of course,
your life,
you know,
tour?
Yeah, yes. No, actually, I don't know if it was that he tried. You know, he's like,
right.
They sent out a thing if you're going to be in any of these cities, and they were all too far away. And then when he was
right.
at the thing in Orlando, I thought, well, I'm going to go see him. You know, then,
right.
and I had to go present.
So you never could make the connection
never
with him
could,
personally.
Never could.
Never seen him.
No.
Turn around.
Where are you? Oh my God.
I want to thank Dan for finding that video. I don't know what your story is where you need to forgive, but probably every last one of us sitting in this audience today need to forgive someone. There are three areas of forgiveness. I didn't think I was going to get emotional this morning. Three areas of forgiveness that could be developed this morning. Forgiving when someone asks for forgiveness, that's not so hard. Forgiving ourselves for situations that we regret, that's more difficult. I come across people all the time that haven't forgiven themselves. But the third one, and the one which I'm going to develop this morning, is forgiving others when they don't ask for forgiveness, or they don't say they're sorry, or they may not even know they have offended us. In my job, I find it difficult to help people find forgiveness if they have no faith background or no understanding of God. I still take them there, and I'll do that when I come to the 70 times 7 part. This is where I take them. But forgiving others when they don't ask, that's the one I work with most in my job. The world is full of people that are hurting, that need to forgive, but they don't. There are several myths out there that I want to mention this morning. When we grew up as children, we learned a little saying that went like this: sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me. That is a saying that is so far from the truth, because most of the emotional injuries I work with are verbal abuse. It is correct, wounds from sticks and stones most often heal. Words wound the soul, and sometimes people never recover. There's a more current version of that old saying that is far more accurate. Sticks and stones may break my bones, but words can kill me. The other myth is an old saying, forgive and forget. This is not only verbalized by some, but so unfair. Those three words are such a big subject, those two words are such a big subject, that I separated them into two sermons. And next Sunday is about forgetting. And you really need to hear that one. And if you didn't hear last Sunday's sermon on the forgiveness this way between us and God, Karen has DVDs that you could borrow, or it's also on the web. Today I want to focus on forgiving others when they don't ask for forgiveness and they don't act like they're sorry. Life is full of these stories. Some we let go pretty quickly, but others linger with us for a lifetime. In today's society, we know little about forgiveness and much more about getting even. My brother wrote an article for a paper that we put out at University Heights years ago, and this was back in 1996, and I share this story with you. David Jacobson was snatched off the streets of Beirut on a beautiful May morning in 1985. He was gagged, blindfolded, stripped of his underwear, and chained to a wall in a windowless, unheated room. He was allowed only one watery meal and one supervised visit to the washroom daily. David was treated cruelly with constant threats to his life. After the 18-month ordeal was over, David wrote, "When you can forgive those who try to harm you, you lessen the harm they're able to do to you. When I was able to forgive those men, I was finally able to get on with my life back in California." Why are experts promoting forgiveness? Because forgiveness allows the offender to get on with their life. Forgiveness is not a denial or a pretense. It is not minimizing the tragedy. It does not exclude help and counsel. In fact, forgiveness calls for all of these things. Forgiveness is surrendering one's right to hurt back. Forgiveness is relinquishing the need to get even. The words of a deeply hurt Harold Smith rings true. Never does a person stand so tall and so free as when he or she forgives revenge and dares to forgive. Forgoes revenge and dares to forgive. Forgiveness is, in fact, about getting on with our life. That's the end of the article. I want you to repeat the Lord's Prayer with me. This is a traditional prayer. And I want us to repeat it out loud together. And it should show up on the screen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. I chose this traditional version, King James Version, because we're more familiar with the word sin than we are with the word debtor or trespass, as used in other versions. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. There are very few times in God's promises to us that there is a condition attached. This is one of them, and where it has significant importance. Our forgiveness comes from God this way, with a condition that we forgive this way. We live out our forgiveness in the world around us. That's what He wants. A bit later, I'll give you a suggestion how we might make that work in our own lives. Forgiving is not an easy act. Many spouses hold mental lists of hurts the other spouse has committed. I talk about that in every marriage ceremony that I do. Don't keep a mental list of how your spouse has treated you. Worse yet is keeping a written list. So don't keep a list. Forgiveness is not an option for many. So they head away from each other into the arms of someone who understands them. Forgiveness is often not an option in spousal relationships by the time I get involved in them. Their spirits have been wounded by the other, and so they go into another relationship where eventually the same hurting will usually play out. And I say, oh, if forgiveness had only been given a chance. Dale Galloway, in his book, Dream a New Dream, states, nothing hurts in this world more than a wounded being wounded in your spirit. That happens often, doesn't it? What about the friend who broke the deepest confidence, the parent who never praised you, the employer who quietly dismisses you? Then there is a loss when a marriage goes sour and the horrors of abusive relationships or the pain of alcoholism. Sometimes our wounds hurt so much that we want revenge. In this age of rage, the courts and TV talk shows, they're crowded with victims venting anger and demanding justice. At the same time, experts are beginning to promote forgiveness. Survivor Robin Cashin, in her book, Forgiveness, A Bold Choice, states, when you really think about it, forgiveness is the only sensible response to hurt. And it is true. When you forgive, you no longer go through life emotionally handcuffed to the person who hurt you. Someone wrote about a rabbi whose family was lost in the Holocaust and died, and that he forgave Hitler because he chose not to bring Hitler with him to America. When you forgive, you reclaim your power to choose. It does not matter whether someone deserves forgiveness. They write, you deserve to be free. Experts are reminding us that forgiveness isn't about letting the other person off the hook. It's about pulling the knife out of your own stomach. I often tell people, it's not about letting the offender live rent-free in your heart and mind. This matters because so often the other person is totally unaware of your misery or your hurt. While you are turning inside out, they're getting on with their life. That in part is what Jesus had in mind when he said in Matthew 5, 43 to 45, "You have heard that it is said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemy and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your heavenly Father in heaven." Here again in Matthew 5, Jesus attaches the condition of forgiveness to being a child of God. I would guess that he really meant it. For many, forgiveness is a bitter pill to swallow. It will seem to many like forgiveness diminishes the act against them or makes it feel like you're saying that it never happened or that it was all right. It in no way, shape, or form diminishes the sin or the act committed, and it doesn't hide what happened, but it represents a desire to move on with your life and no longer be shackled to that act, to that person, or to the emotions of that time. Christ's disciple, Peter, who was the outspoken one, asked Jesus, "How many times do you have to forgive?" And Jesus' response is recorded in Matthew 18:21-22. And I use the King James Version here, because this is the one I grew up with, and this is the one I remember the most, and it goes like this. "Then Peter came and said to him, 'Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Up to seven times?' Jesus said to him, 'I do not say to you up to seven times, but up to 70 times seven.'" For those of you who are not very quick at math, the answer is on the overhead for you. Now, I know that Jesus didn't mean that we forgive 490 times, and then on the 491st time, you can laugh and say, "Ha, you don't have to forgive you this time, and I don't forgive you this time." That's not what he meant. There are various interpretations on this scripture, and I'm going to tell you mine is not theological, and perhaps not quite what Jesus had in mind, but this has worked for me, and I share it with you. There are two ways in which forgiveness can happen. It can be an event, or it can be a process. Event is when it happens and it's over and done. But a process is more likely the way we will achieve forgiveness. There's not likely anyone in this audience here that has not experienced a hurt that doesn't require forgiveness. Maybe our parents or grandparents, family members or relatives, from work, a neighbor, the list could go on. It is likely that every one of us have been hurt and they did not say, "I'm sorry, will you forgive me?" That didn't happen. To me, the number 490 suggests to me, and that is why I often use it in my own life, I believe in my inner being that God wants me to forgive. And so I often start out with a prayer that might sound like this. "I know you want me to forgive them, God, but I don't want to. I don't want to." And soon I graduate to the prayer that says, "God, I know you want me to forgive them. Will you help me want to?" Maybe the next step is, "God, you know how much it hurt. But will you help some of that hurt to dissipate?" When I'm sitting with people that have been hurt, whether they have a faith background or not, I tell them that I'm praying for them. And one of the things that I include in my prayer is that the hurt and the pain might dissipate. Add as many steps in there as you need. But we must come to that place where we say, "Thank you, God, for helping me to forgive them. Now, if you're just on the starting point today and the ending point is over here, you're on a journey, because it's not likely going to be an event, at least not for most of us. I have a friend, Dick True, from Forest Grove Community Church. He's a professional counselor, and when I have a new thing to work, to find understanding for, I call Dick. He sent me this quote that his wife, Carol, used to understand when forgiveness has happened. And the quote goes like this. You know that you have forgiven someone when they can pass through your mind harmlessly. I'm going to repeat that. I want you to get that. You know that you have forgiven someone when they can pass through your mind harmlessly. Recently, Sandy and I visited a cousin in Alberta that had moved to a new location to put distance between her and her father, so to speak, to start new. See, her father, a Christian, had been arrested and charged with sexual charges with children. He was a pedophile. She was one of his victims. My cousin understands forgiveness, and when our conversation went with to her father when we were eating dinner, I asked her if she had been able to forgive her father, and she thought that she had. Later in the conversation, she began to cry as she talked about her father and got quite emotional. Then she said that she thought she had forgiven him, but then there's a flood of emotions, and she still has a way to go. Sandy and I tried to reassure her that she was on the right journey, and that in her case, that forgiveness was a process and ongoing. When we seek in our hearts and minds to forgive someone, that does not mean that things go back to normal and everything is as it once was. Not generally so. My cousin has a no-contact court order against her father, and he may die without ever seeing her again. While terrible hurts may take only minutes to inflict, forgiving the person responsible for the wound requires time and often spiritual or professional help. Some people never reach the final stages of forgiveness. Those hurt in childhood by people who they loved and trusted may find the process particularly difficult. For those who have faced a pedophile relative or friend, they often live in a silent, dark inner world. University of Victoria Sexual Assault Center posted the following statistic on childhood sexual abuse statistics, and I believe it was in 1999. It says, 1 in 3 females and 1 in 6 males in Canada experience some form of sexual abuse before the ages of 18. If those statistics hold here, there's 8 or 9 women that have been sexually abused. There's 3 or 4 guys that have been sexually abused. Most of the hurts that we feel in life are bigger than the color of a Mr. Freezy. But, and this is tough, but regardless of the hurt or woundedness, Jesus does not give any exceptions to not forgiving this way. You can search the Bible through, and it will never tell you, Jesus said, that you don't have to forgive if this happened to you, or if that happened to you, or if that happened to you. And that's one of the tough things about this message. If we claim His name as our Savior, forgiveness is a condition of His forgiveness. As we come to the response time, if you need more help than an upraised hand this morning that we give to you, and a few prayers for you this week, you can contact Pastor Curtis or myself, and we'll try and help you. Most of the help I try to give is from a spiritual perspective. And that's where I would journey with you. I'm not a professional counselor. Pastor Curtis has more experience with that than I. But if you're sitting here this morning, and in the response time, you put up your hand and say, pray for me, we'll do that. We'll do that through this week. But if you need more help than that, most of you know how to get a hold of Pastor Curtis or myself, and we would be glad to try and journey with you. I'm going to invite us all to stand. And if you're new with us this morning, I just am going to ask the worship team or Karen, whoever's coming forward, to just come forward and play. And I ask us to just simply bow our heads and close our eyes. Get in a space just with you and God. And this morning, if you need and you want us to pray for you for an issue in your life or for issues in your life, just put your hand up and put it down again and we'll pray for it. Yes. 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 Anyone else? Father, this morning we know that forgiveness is a very difficult step. And there are those of us here this morning that are struggling with issues that sometimes go back a long way. And this morning, Father, for those who raise their hands, for those that may be silently standing here in the darkness of former abuses or former issues, pray that you would begin planting that seed, that dream of forgiving, so that they can get on with their life. Pray, Father, for each one of us, that as we leave here today, as we enjoy time of fellowship, that we go with the desire to be a forgiving Christian, one that would honor and reflect what you have a desire for in our own life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You can have a seat for just a moment as I begin to introduce communion today. In just a few moments, we're going to gather together and share in the bread and the cup. I just want to bring together some of the themes that Ray spoke about in relation to what we will have together on this communion table. Forgiveness is the theme of this series, and as he shared last week, it's between us and God, and really that's often what we think of when we have communion together, of what Jesus did through his broken body and his blood that was poured out for us on the cross. Yet every single time that we read about communion within Scripture, it's done in relationship with one another, which was the theme of today. It speaks of our forgiveness as we remember what Jesus did for us as he died on the cross to create a new way for us to restore our relationship with God. Yet at the same time, it's something that we have to take together as the body of Christ, as people who understand what Jesus did for us. You know, and one of the most famous passages, one we often read, is as the Apostle Paul writes a letter to the Corinthians, and it talks about how Christ gave up his body for us. His earthly body took the punishment for all of our sins, even though he was sinless. He was judged so that we don't have to be judged. We get our forgiveness through him. In the same way, it says and talks about his blood being the new covenant, the new promises of what God has for us in heaven, that it is a new way of relating with God through Jesus Christ, his Son. Yet that passage, even though it speaks to what we're about to do, it is framed, it is bookmarked, it, before and after it is a passage that speaks about how we do it in relationship and community. And he actually scolds them for saying, basically, you haven't forgiven one another. How can you truly understand what it is that you're doing and taking in community? so this morning as we come to the table, maybe there's someone that has come to your mind that you need to seek forgiveness for and encourage to do that. Maybe they're here this morning and you want to speak to them even before you come up and just say something to them. Maybe they're not here, but God has laid it on your heart. I don't want to hinder you from coming. I want everyone who is coming up to the table this morning to recognize what God has done for them and also what they are called to do with each other. Because it's through our love for one another, the forgiveness that we find in each other, that we truly experience the relationship that we have with God in our lives and with others who have God in their lives here on earth. So this morning we're going to come up, we're going to take bread from the trays as we stand. I'm going to invite you all who want to come up and take the bread and take the cup. You're able to stand here at the foot of the cross and eat that bread and drink that cup, or you're welcome to take it back to your seat with you if you want to dwell a little further about it. If you don't feel like you can this morning, that's just fine. But if you are leaning towards coming up, I encourage you to do that. Just stand up and say, God, I recognize what you've done for me. I know I haven't lived a perfect life. Thank you for your forgiveness. And I'm going to. To you to forgive those who I need to. I encourage you to come up and do that this morning. So today as we eat the bread, which represents the broken body of Jesus, and as we drink the cup, which symbolizes the new covenant in his blood, we come together in that way to celebrate this Lord's Supper, this communion, forgiven and united before him and with each other. I want to pray. And then as we come, there's going to be a song that Karen and Amy are going to lead us or sing for us this morning. Join me as we pray. Father, we recognize there are many great things that you have done for us, the greatest through your Son, Jesus Christ. And today as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we recognize and remember and celebrate what he did for us and the forgiveness that we have found in your eyes, the forgiveness that we have found that restores our relationship with you, that gives us a heaven, an eternal place to be with you, but also that creates us, gives us entrance into your kingdom here and now. So God, as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we are so excited about the potential, about the things that you are doing in our lives because of your Son, that you speak to our hearts, you've forgiven us, you have opened our minds to you. And yet at the same time, we walk up with others around us. And so, God, I invite you to speak into our lives and into our hearts. Encourage us to forgive others that maybe we haven't yet. That you continue to work in us to allow us to see the meaning behind what you have done for us and those lives around us. We accept your forgiveness, and we also accept the call to forgive others. And with your help,